I like to write songs not on guitar or even on an instrument. I like to write them on my bike. I get a rhythm and a pace and a breathing, and there's a certain kind of churning, and something wells up, and it happens. I cycle down through Brixton, then I get the thing going, I kind of go through Kennington. By the time I get up towards Westminster Bridge, I know that there's a payphone there. I run into the payphone, dial my number, the answer phone comes on, and I sing the song into the answer phone, and then I go into town and forget about it. And then I come home, I've forgotten the song, I play it back on the answer phone, and it sounds good.
When life's a bitter pill you swallow down, with your last breath and find me alone and trapped amidst superlatives and grief. Shine underneath. I was thrown out of the crib into the snow. I was born to entertain, so here I go.
A decade after he first emerged with The Teardrop Explodes, Julian Cope is back with an album that shuts the door on the 80s, when Cope tried on more than his share of rock myths and even made up a few of his own.
Good evening, welcome to Top of the Pops. What an exciting show we've got for you. We've got groups like Rainbow, Stray Cat, Adam and the Ants, all sorts of good things on a Thursday. We start with Teardrop Explodes.
We wanted to be Blondie, we wanted to be enormous. And we had to take acid, because we had to arrive on Top of the Pops tripping. So as much as we were desperate to do a real British icon, we had to take the piss immediately. It was terrifying.
It was terrifying?
Terrifying.
What was terrifying?
That time. I just could not behave responsibly. You know, I was like 22, 23, and because I wanted everything. I wanted to give people everything. Because they didn't want it. They wanted this kind of like trivial little pop trip, which is fair enough. And I was foisting upon them all these kind of enormous emotions. One time we played at Nottingham, big place, and we went into sleeping gas, and sleeping gas started to ramble. And then I started to ramble along with it. And there were all these girls and their parents and all this kind of stuff. And I started saying why they were here and what they wanted to be doing. And in actual fact, they all wanted to be doing these things to me. And I didn't want to be doing it to them, but I really did, and all this kind of stuff. And it got so convoluted that in the end, they kind of booed. And then I started to realize that me as a pop star was not a morally sound proposition.
Are you now quite proud of your self-destruction?
No. I'm not proud of it. I'm just not so embarrassed by it. I was always embarrassed by it before because failure is not something to be proud of, you know? I'd love to have been better at it, because it would have made my life a lot easier. So I feel in a way maybe it wasn't meant to be so easy.
The Teardrops finally shuddered to a halt while recording a third album to fulfill contractual obligations. Cope had had his stab at pop stardom, and now his drug experiments fueled an increasingly convincing impression of his heroes, acid-crazed rock visionaries of the 60s like Rocky Erickson, Sky Saxon, and Sid Barrett.
Write the talent you need, write the talents you see, write the talent we're for me.
This is 1984. The Teardrop Explodes have long since imploded. You're on your own. And you're gathering a reputation for being completely off your head, which this would seem to further.
I was always very aware of my mental state. You don't make an album and call it fried if you're not aware of your mental state. We were compared with Barrett a lot, and being compared with Sid Barrett was a real drag at the time, because 2 years before I'd have been really pleased. But unfortunately, the reason that it sounded that way was because it was what I was capable of. This song doesn't have any bass on it, just because we forgot to put bass on it.
For a while, it seemed as if Cope had put himself beyond the pale, but he still harbored the desire to combine pop stardom with personal intensity.
And I found that whatever I did was a Julian being weird. Which is a real problem. That's why I kind of had to come back and compete. I was determined to compete. I really wanted to make records that sounded like other people's records. I yearned for records that sounded like other people's records.
Because your burnout period, your weirdness had made you sort of meaningless.
Completely.
Now, in the early 80s, a group called Teardrop Explodes made their mark with several big hits. As so often happens, they went their separate ways. But the lead singer is on his own now with, appropriately enough, for this show, World, Shut Your Mouth, it's Julian Cope.
After nursing himself back to health with a determined spell of speedwalking, Cope signed to Island Records. Now clad in rock leathers, Cope enjoyed his first hit in 5 years with World Shut Your Mouth, off 1987's St. Julian album.
People forget that if you go into a real kind of deep recess of your mind and you feel very lost and horrible, that sometimes you're just yearning to be embraced by Wogan. It's a terrible thing to say, but it's true.
Despite the personalized mic stand, St. Julian was a depressingly professional, packaged approximation of a rock god.
It was a totally packaged era, Julian Cope group. It was like JCB. You know, it's meant to be really crap. It was good, actually. I like it now. I did compete. Fortunately, making records that sound like other people's are fine as an intellectual exercise, but they're boring as hell to listen to. So I did two albums that I'm really bored with now. It was like a kind of a don't trust me. If I say don't trust me. And, you know, playing around with the idea of me being a charlatan. It was just an intellectual trip.
Cope's new album, Peggy Suicide, bids good riddance to the 1980s and the sterile perfection of the designer pop record.
89 was a time when people were taking their bags and just running out of the 80s. To an extent where your average 80s man in adverts nowadays just looks like a chump. And I think that was really why I had to record an album that was a double album. It had to be very, very cheap. Very, very fast, very loose. I needed to be an ambassador of looseness.
Recorded in a tiny demo studio in which the band performed this daily blessing, Peggy Suicide is a deliberately primitive collection, shot through with Cope's newfound obsessions with the state of the earth and the poll tax.
The poll tax absolutely just woke me up. It was like a punch in the face. I really believe that fate made us decide to live in Lambeth. I think that we could have ended up in Wandsworth and it would have been fate kind of nudging us aside. I think if you live in Wandsworth, it's very easy to pay. Feel bad about it and pay.
But Cope being Cope, his involvement with poll tax protest blossomed via one of the characters in his personal mythology, Sqwubbsy, a spirit force nearly 8 foot tall, whom Cope first dreamed and then encountered in the shop window of a Shaftesbury Avenue theatrical costumier.
Last year, everybody was very depressed by the poll tax, etc., etc., so I took to wearing him. I like the idea that I'm entertaining. I think that as soon as I forget the idea that I'm entertaining, I fall into the awful abyss called the serious artist, which is terrible, you know? I hate that kind of role. Because as soon as you start saying that you're a serious artist, it means you're not serious at all.
I was born to win, to change, so here I go. Once more, I was shown the door before I got to sing. Only to be now forgotten. Only to be now forgotten.
So, Julian, do you still want to be huge? Do you want it all again?
I'd always want to be huge. There's nothing worse than being happy with your cultiness. Then you just start becoming whimsical, you know? You've got to attack the muse with both hands and say, just don't let whim get in the way. You know, when people accuse me of being whimsical, then I just freak, because I'm not, really not.
Mark Cooper reporting, and Julian Cope's album is released this week. We are now in the middle of the 5th London Lesbian and Gay Film Festival. The largest of its kind in the world, its very success is a testament.
Were responsible for